Morning.
Morning.
We call to order this February 21st, 2023, City Council meeting for the City of Wichita Falls. And I ask Dr. Mark Bender for First Christian Church. How are you, sir?
Good morning.
Please give her a vacation.
Let us pray. Eternal God, at the beginning of this new day and the beginning of a new session, we give thanks for what will take place here today as well as what will take place throughout our city and community. We're grateful for all who go about their work of ensuring the operation of our city services and public works. We're grateful for the businesses and organizations and individuals who demonstrate their love for our city through their investment of their energy and resources. And we're grateful for our city's leaders, both here in this room and at work throughout our community. For the abundance of gifts that you've endowed our city with, we humbly offer you our thanks. Today, O God, we pray that your wisdom, your creativity, your guidance might be upon all gathered in this place and for all who are represented in this place. May this meeting be marked by sustained energy and unmistakable integrity, and may the business of this day and the work of this session be characterized by deep respect, by clarity of purpose, and a resolve to serve our neighbors with compassion and impartiality. Grant these leaders grace so that through their discussions and decisions, they might solve problems, enhance the well-being of our community, and serve our citizens well. For that's our prayer. Amen.
Thank you, sir. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Well, today we only have one presentation, and it's going to be our Employee of the Month, Luke Baker from Public Works. Luke, come on forward, Luke. Feeling better?
Much, thank
there you.
There
you go.
Sorry about last time, but kind of unavoidable.
That's all right. That's all right. I guess we have a video here.
I am Luke Baker. I've been with the city for 27 years. The last 19 have been as a senior pump plant maintenance mechanic with water purification.
He's one of the few of the long-tenured employees that we have here, so it's a tremendous asset to have somebody like that here with all their knowledge, their history, and the with all of the equipment out in the treatment plant, and really to show those new employees that we hire now how to get their job done and do it efficiently.
I kind of learned a little bit about them, their learning style, before I really start teaching them. I have them start out watching me, and slowly progress over into, okay, now you're the one doing it. To where, when they've done it several times, last but not least, okay, teach me. Teach me like I've never been here, and then we know you've got it.
I do wish we had more of him. Unfortunately, as people retire and we start to see that turnover with the tenured employees, he's one of the few that we have here left, and it's, like I say, it's just a tremendous asset to have him.
I had a kid ask me one time what my favorite thing about this job is, and I told him that I have been inside of a raw water line 30 feet underground and 160 feet in the air changing the light bulb on top of a water tower in the same day. You can't beat that kind of, you know, versatility in your job.
Luke, that is awesome that you said that. It's going to give me a giggle. We do value our employees here at Wichita Falls, and like Mark was saying, long tenured employees. You come with a wealth of knowledge, and I couldn't do what you do. That's for sure. And I'm glad that you said that. You know, there's like almost something new every day, and I can imagine with our water treatment plants, you're pretty busy. I don't think there's probably a day that you don't have something you're fixing out there.
Oh, definitely.
Definitely.
I've got a stack of work orders waiting on me right now.
So we're not going to waste any more time with this then. We're going to get you back to work. So in appreciation, we have a letter here, a check and a gift card. And then we have a plaque here for the Employee of the Month from February 2023, Luke Baker for water purification, everybody.
Oh, hey, can I get my wife to come up?
Yeah, please? Yeah, absolutely.
Can I get one?
Yeah,
for sure. I have, you know,
oh, yeah.
One keeps me going in this, too.
Good morning, Mayor and Council members. Your consent agenda this morning is pretty brief. It includes your February 7th meeting minutes, as well as the receipt of minutes from your MPO Transportation Policy Committee, the Park Board, and Planning and Zoning Commission.
May I have any desire to move anything from the consent agenda to the regular agenda? Being none, I'll accept a motion to accept the regular agenda as presented.
Make that motion.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. The motion passes.
First item on your regular agenda is 6A, which is an ordinance replacing Ordinance 37-2022 that was amended by Ordinance 64-2022. The fee schedule is applied to city operations, providing for severability, providing that such ordinance shall not be codified, and providing the effective date.
Make that a motion.
Second.
Okay, James?
Before you, Council, is a cleanup fee ordinance and an adjustment of certain fees. It does several things. First, it combines the past ordinances that we passed in September of last year, and then we amended the health services, specifically animal control fees. And so what this ordinance does is it combines those two ordinances into one single ordinance and then makes adjustments to the airport hangar fees and incidental fees. It adjusts the credit card service fees in the finance section. It adjusts the rental fees for artificial turf and grass at the sports complex, and it changes the tennis fees from adults and individuals to juniors and families. And then finally, it adds a credit card charge for alarm services with PD, and then it adjusts the towing fees to allow a 25% increase to account for inflation and gas increases. And staff's here to answer any questions you have on those specific sections.
Does anyone on council have any comments or questions? Please. Any comments or questions from the public? Being none, we have a motion and second to approve an ordinance replacing ordinance number 37-2022 that was amended by ordinance 64-2022. The fee schedule applied to city operations, providing for severability, providing that such ordinance shall not be codified, and providing an effective date. Please cast your votes. The motion passes.
Item 7A is a resolution of the City of Wichita Falls, Texas, authorizing the city attorney to proceed with litigation against the property owners at 3003 Cumberland Avenue in Wichita Falls and under the Texas Local Government Code, Chapter 54.
Is there a motion?
Make that motion.
Second.
Just briefly, this is a resolution to allow the city attorney's office to file a suit against the property at 3003 Cumberland, and Terry Floyd with Development Services has a brief presentation he'll present.
Good morning, Mayor and Council. Terry Floyd, Director of Development Services. I'm just here briefly, wanted to show you some pictures from a warrant that was served on the 26th here by multiple departments to get a real scope and picture of the problem here at 3003 Cumberland Avenue. Just real quickly for reference, as you know, Cumberland Avenue, you can see Kemp right here. Kell runs right down here. So it's just outside of our revitalization area, but nearby there on Cumberland. Here's an aerial view as well of the property. And here you can already see some stuff from our aerial. Single-family home that was built, real quickly, it was built in 1926. The owners are Salvador and Mariana Prieto. We think the property was purchased, we know the property was purchased in 2020. It might have previously been a rental or or rent-to-own type unit in 2020. Or prior to 2020. As you can see here in the front yard of the property, you can see some couches and other things. We believe the couches may have been removed since these pictures, but there has been minimal to no progress on this property since the 26th of January or over the last few years. Again, you can see more pictures of the scope here. Wanted to point out a couple things. Here you can see some standing water, and although in January the water may have a little ice on it, when it becomes springtime and other, these will be habitat for mosquitoes and pose a health risk, definitely. Here you can see a level of trash and other things here, even buried within that, some groceries and other things and food that, again, provides habitat for rodents and other vermin. Again, this is on the front porch. You can see, again, the magnitude of the trash and the debris here. Again, that's also on the front porch. Here, just a little bit more evidence of food that's left in the open and some evidence of some insect and other type activity on some food items as well. Again, some evidence of rodents that have chewed through a box here, and again, more of that. This is the side of the house. Here you can see some type of accessory type unit over here. I believe someone is living in there as well. Again, you can see a scope of the debris and again see the adjacency of that to the neighbors here on the other side. On the other side of that, you can see where we were at previously. You can see the car. There's a car here. We don't know if the car runs or not, but we do know that evidence of cats and so forth that are living there in that. And here you can see the fence that the neighbor built to shield themselves from the debris and also from the view of this. Again, the adjacency to that, and we'll talk a little bit about that from a fire perspective. Here again, you can see just in front of the car, looking back to the front towards Cumberland, more of the debris in the scope of that. At the time, our building official did not note any deficiencies with the building, but it was difficult to tell because there was stuff all around it. Here in the backyard, you can see the little garage and shed. Again, you can see the magnitude of the debris and trash that's piled up against that. More evidence of water standing, significant water standing on the property. It was difficult to assess the condition of this structure here because, as we'll see here in a minute, it's full of trash and debris as well. Same situation here. You can see another picture of that and some evidence of that as well. Also, you can see the trees and other things that are up against this. In the event that there was a fire in any of this debris, it would pose a risk to the adjacent neighbors because of that and the fuel and the fire. Again, there's an outbuilding here. You can see evidence of some gas cans, some other types of flammables there that pose a risk and a significant risk to the property and their condition. Again, more of the same, some water that's built here in this and general trash and debris. Here was some evidence of something being cooked outside on a pot. So again, we see the fire. We see there may have been some indication that might have got a little out of hand before. So again, that fire danger and that significant risk to the properties adjacent to that. Here you can see some evidence of some shielding that was tried to keep the view of this from the staff and from our code enforcement division. And again, scope and magnitude, some leaves and other trash here against the property line. Again, more of the same on the front porch. And so we've been dealing with this property for a number of years, I think since back before 2020. So this has been 3-4 year saga. I know there's been over 30 citations and additional citations last week on this property because, again, from the code enforcement's perspective, there has been no progress on this building at all in this property. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions for you.
Yes, sir. Request, go ahead.
Just have one question. How are you going to, once we go into it, how are we going to proceed with their personal, all of it is their personal property, but how are you going to exceed with what you're going to throw away and what we're going to keep, what they're going to keep?
I may have the legal department kind of gives some indication of that, but most of this would be, you know, we would have to, in order to remove anything, we would have to hire an abatement contractor to do that. But I'll ask the legal department maybe to kind of specify on that, how we would go about that.
Ultimately, without going into our legal strategy, you would typically, if it's stored outside, then it's probably going to be have rodent or insect infestation, or you know, be subject to weather conditions to where it probably does not have any value. But ultimately, that's something we'll have to figure out along the way.
Okay. Let me know.
Mm-hmm.
All right, thank you.
Go ahead, Tim.
How are we going to proceed? You said there's been lots of citations given to them. Is that a jail offense if it's not? Or is that a money offense? And if we have to go in and clean it up, who gets the bill on that?
I may let the legal department talk a little more about that, because that does come into the strategy, although I slowed it. What is it? I play a lawyer on TV.
That's right.
But I'll let James answer that question as well for you, counsel.
Ultimately, you got to look at Chapter 54 and the code enforcement as two parallel roads. So you can issue citations from a criminal perspective, but in a Chapter 54, what you're looking at is an abatement of the nuisance, essentially. So who funds that? Ultimately, the cities will fund it on the front side. At the end, you know, if we make it that far, you know, we're successful, the city would fund that on the front end. Then you could look at possibly a judgment lien on the back end, but most likely, as these individuals probably don't have the funding to pay for it themselves if ordered by a judge. Okay. Yes, sir.
All right, James, we're talking about local city ordinances and state law. I mean, this is not something out of the blue. It's been on the books forever. We've tried to work with people. It doesn't work with some, and this is an extreme situation. The neighbors have put up with this for over 10 years, and they've done everything that they should to try to alleviate the problem, and here it is on our hands, and this is how we're going to deal with it. And the funding, the money that's spent to clean up this, will that become a lien on this property, that amount?
It is. It would be, you can file a judgment lien without getting into legal strategy at this point in public. Yes, yes, yes. A judgment lien is possible. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Yes, on counsel? Any comments or questions from the public? A motion and second to approve resolution of the City of Wichita Falls, Texas, authorizing the city attorney to proceed with litigation against the property owners at 3003 Cumberland Avenue, Wichita Falls, Texas, under Texas Local Government Code, Chapter 54. Please cast your votes. Motion passes.
Item 7B is a resolution that would authorize the city manager to execute a one-year lease agreement, renewable up to four times, with the Wichita Falls Federal Credit Union for the amount of $1,500 per month.
Make that a motion.
Second.
Okay.
Good morning, Mayor and City Council. This is a housekeeping item, just time to update our lease with the credit union. Just some basic information here. We've increased the rent from $1,000 to $1,500 a month. We've tied any future rate increases to the consumer price index, and this is a one-year lease with an option to renew for four additional years if both parties agree to. I have Mrs. Stacy Rogers. She's the CEO of the credit union here, and if you got any questions for us, be more than happy to answer them.
John, just remind us again how long it's been at 1,000, several years.
Well over 20 years that I can recall. So it's we just kind of lapsed in getting the lease update. To give you some history here, this credit union, probably the largest percentage of its membership are city employees. There's some other groups too that have been recruited over the years to join the credit union, but
I've been a member of the credit union since I started working for this city 32 years ago.
Okay. Any council have any questions? Right. Any comments or questions from the public? All right. Thank you, John. Being done, we have a motion and a second to approve a resolution authorizing city manager to execute a one-year lease agreement renewable up to four times with the Wichita Falls Federal Credit Union for the amount of $1,500 a month. Please cast your votes. Motion passes.
Mayor, that takes us to item eight, other council matters. We do have several staff reports to give this morning, and John is up first to give us an update on the personal mobility device or scooter ordinance.
Good morning. We're approaching the one-year anniversary of the scooter ordinance, so we figured we'd kind of give you an update of the progress of the program, as well as where we're at and maybe some potential ordinance changes. We only have one active scooter company in operation right now. That's WF Goat. We've had two other entities inquire about opening scooter operations in the Central Business District. One was a local company, but they never followed through with the implementation. They did all the paperwork. They even filed the fee, but nothing came of it. We have a national company, Bird, but they'll only open up in Wichita Falls on a much broader scale. Towards the end of this slide is just some general information for you and the public, 20 devices per company. The area is GPS fenced in the Central Business District at base to rent the scooters. And operations right now cease at 11 p.m., and that's a voluntary move made by WF Goat. Here's some statistics for WF Goat. They've incurred 4,488 trips. They were not open for operation during the colder months of the year, December and January, so they averaged about 560 rentals per month. They don't provide service on Monday. There are seven scooter docking stations, and I'll show you what one of those look like here in a second. And the rates are $1 to access the scooter and about 30 cents per minute of operation. And to date, and we looked into this, and I want to thank WFPD for getting back with us. We've had one accident injury reported. Both WF Goat validated that, and PD also indicated that a report was filed on it. So this is what one of their docking stations look like right now. So pretty basic. We can put these units pretty much anywhere as long as we've got clearance on the sidewalk for the operation of pedestrians and people with ADA issues. So to date, we've had three formal complaints, and by formal complaints, I mean somebody's actually contacted our department to voice their concerns. Two of them had to do with the operation of the scooters, particularly at night. Not obeying traffic laws was one of the big issues, riding on the sidewalk, and also conflicts with pedestrians. And I know council has brought it up a couple times. Councilor Jackson did, and so did Councilor Whiteley. Other issues that we've had is the use of scooters by underage users and scooter litter. And what does that mean? One of the three formal complaints we received, I guess it was after a windstorm or something, but all the scooters had blown over. They weren't seated in their docking station. One phone call, and I would say probably within an hour, the issue was corrected. It basically was just like somebody stacked a bunch of scooters up on the sidewalk there. To kind of address some of these concerns, we worked with Goat to install little small signs on each docking station to address the first three concerns. That seemed to help a little bit. Didn't correct the problem entirely, but it did get our message across. The other item that was used, and this was a decision made by GOAT, was to cease their hours of operation past 11 p.m. each night. And again, I want to say GOAT has been very responsive. Anytime we've had an issue, phone call, an email, text, they get after it and get the problem corrected quickly. We also asked before this presentation for downtown Wichita Falls Development to conduct a survey of their business community. And basically, the complaints centered around underage users. So where do we go from here? I think there's some changes that probably need to be made to the ordinance moving forward, and that's one of the things I'd like your input on. One request made by GOAT was to expand the boundaries of the current fenced area from the core central business district to include the MPEC and Convention Hotel. I've been talking to Bird, the national company, last week. They've asked to open up the entire community for scooter operations and such. And give you some background, Bird has already contacted Midwestern State University. According to Bird, MSU is favorable of the program. The issue is they're not going to do anything until the city of Wichita Falls adopts an ordinance to make it citywide. Right now, there are no set hours of operation in our ordinance. I think that's something that we need to look at right now. Current ordinance allows for 24 hours of day per day. GOAT has asked that we expand the hours or allow for later hours. And if that's a direction we want to go, that can all be controlled through the app. Age restrictions, there's no restrictions on the age of the users. One of the things that visiting with the GOAT operation on is they were looking at Saturdays and Sundays using ID to restrict access to their scooters. When I talked to Bird about that, their issue is not everybody has identification if they're an adult. That might work, and that's something we can work on, but that might work if we're trying to limit underage operations. And just a list here of maybe some other considerations. I know that GOAT limits their speed at 15 miles an hour. We might want to look at putting that in the ordinance. Some of these scooters can go up over 20 miles an hour. Limit operations of mobility devices on roadways that exceed certain speed thresholds. And a good example of that, everything downtown is 30. I believe Scott Street is 35 and even 40 in some sections. We certainly wouldn't want these operating in a speed environment of anything over 40 miles an hour. One thing that I've seen that other organizations do, as I say organizations, municipal governments, is to have the operator company report any accidents and incidents so we can have a current kind of a update on what's going on with their scooters instead of waiting to do an annual report. We can look at the accident in real time and see if there was anything that maybe our ordinance could have done to prevent it. Helmet requirements. There's nothing in the law, ordinance or state law that requires a helmet, but I've seen where some cities have required helmets for underage users. So that might be something you as a council consider. And maybe even look at some roadway type regulations. We won't let these scooters operate on sidewalks, but if they're going to be in the roadway, maybe encourage them to stay. And this is just an example on the far right side of the roadway as they operate. I know one night downtown I saw, was watching Indiana Street, and we had scooters running up and down both lanes on Indiana Street. And that's certainly not the operator company's fault, but that might be something we look at. And Bird asked if we do look at expanding the boundaries to include the host city to increase the allowance above 20 units. They were looking at starting with maybe 50 scooters, maybe up to 80, but they were in favor of us increasing that to 200 units as a cap. So with that, if you've got any questions, I've got the owner operator of WF Goat here. I'll be more than happy to try to answer any questions you may have on this topic.
Council members? Tim?
I just had a question. You said that they're looking at the age of the operators. Is there an age for bicycle riding on the streets in the bicycle lane?
No, sir. There's nothing in the law that prohibits any age bicycle user, to my knowledge.
And does it require you have to have a helmet to ride in the street?
No, sir. No.
Even with on the bicyclers, they would require all the time, the helmets all the time?
No, sir. There's no state law that requires bicycle users to force them to use a helmet. Now, events like Hotter Than Hell, since that's a private event, that's a requirement under their agreement to participate in the event that you have to have a helmet. So that's why you see quite a few people wearing helmets during the Hotter Than Hell.
I think some of the ideas are great on expanding, especially the area. You know, that, I think that's a big deal. The 11 p.m. thing, I don't agree with expanding that at all, but that's just my opinion. But that's tough. 11 p.m. is late. It's late enough, I think. So, but, I mean, I think it's great that we're looking at other people coming in. MSU definitely needs something over there, but we're also going to have to expand the area. So, and it's, so the, right now, the impact's not included in the area?
No, sir.
Really?
It is not.
Wow.
We can certainly address that. And given all the construction going on right there, I would imagine that was probably one of the considerations, you know, we made in presenting the original ordinance. But now that that construction's moving to the interior of the building, I think probably by, I would say maybe October 1st or when the facility opens, and I'll ask Blake on that. Are we still looking at mid to late summer? So I would say probably a summer move.
And so when you expand the area, then you get into, are they allowed on the hike and bike trail?
I don't believe so. I think the hike and bike trail prohibits any type of motorized device, and I think that's part of our grand assurances. But we can look into it, and I can follow up with TxDOT to see if that is a concern. But I'm pretty sure our ordinance limits any type of motorized device on our trail.
Steve?
How far can these go on a charge?
That I would ask Mr. Nunez to come up. How far do they go, sir? $45 to $50 total miles per charge. That's pretty impressive.
If they run out of charge, do they have to push them back to the docking station?
Yes, more than likely.
Instead of just dropping them?
With, yeah. Okay. And we have not had a problem with what I'm going to call scooter litter downtown. Like I said, we had that one issue, but it looked like we had high winds come in. The other thing we require... And I've seen, I know the Austin ordinance included language in this, but if they were going to put a docking station at a location, even though it's public right-of-way and the city has to sign off on it, but in the Austin ordinance, it required them to get adjacent property owner permission as well, because that could potentially impact their foot traffic in and out of their business, depending on where that docking station was located. So that might be something else we look at considering.
Yeah. Well, I'm in favor of that also. John, I'd like to be on that committee when you start it again.
Yes, sir.
Start up again. Don't forget.
I will include all you right. And get your input, Councilor.
Right. Thank you.
Go ahead, Tim.
I think it would be good to I don't know if you'd say waive a age, because a lot of people that may come to the impact might want to come downtown, and they got children. So I guess if you could see over the handlebars, is the only way that you could enforce that.
Well, one thing we saw right after Christmas, it looked like a lot of youngsters got scooters for their Christmas present. So we're seeing scooters all over town already. The only difference is this ordinance regulates people or companies that rent scooters for a business. So scooters are here to stay. I would imagine quite a few people even probably bring their personal scooters downtown to use them. But the bottom line, the companies have been great. Bird, the national company, has been very persistent about coming to Wichita Falls. About, I'm going to say, 8, 9, 10 months ago, they opened up in Beaumont, Texas, and that program's been successful. I agree with you, Councilor Browning, that MSU, they see the need. They would be the ones managing the scooter operations on their campus. We would probably get heavily involved when we've got on city streets and such. I know our airmen in training is another group that could probably benefit from scooter operations. One thing Bird had indicated that they were going to reach out to Shepherd Air Force Base to see about implementing scooters on base. That would be a decision between them and the federal government, of course, but I could see Shepherd personnel using the scooters, particularly on the weekends. But again, we're going to be in a situation where they're going to, in that case, Caulfield Road, Lawrence, Midwestern Parkway, and such. So, City View, yeah, we're going to have to keep a close eye on that.
Yep. Anybody else? Thank you, sir.
So, get us your feedback. This is your ordinance.
Yeah.
So if you want some of these changes, you all got to let us know on these. John posed several questions to you, so thanks. Second item is an update on the ARPA-funded projects. Paul Menzies.
Morning, Mayor and Council. Not going to take too long on these, hopefully. I put on the dais this morning, this is what you got in your update on Friday as well, is the just a reminder, the list of projects that are included in your ARPA-funded plan that you approved last summer. And then if you flip that over, the projects that Jessica will go over in the presentation after mine, in your basically your fund balance projects that were approved as part of the budget. So what we're going to talk about today is that longer list, or right now is that longer list on the front. And just a reminder, the American Rescue Plan Act, the federal government in 2021 provided $350 billion for state and local governments. Our share was $29.1 million. Received that over two different tranches, half in May of 21, then half last year, May of 22. Usage is severely restricted, as you would expect with federal money, in accordance with U.S. Treasury guidance, and it seems to be getting more strict every day. And just a reminder, these funds, according to the Treasury guidance, need to be allocated by the end of 2024, and the projects closed out and wrapped up by the end of 2026. And we'll talk a little bit about that at the end. When you guys last year were considering your project list and what projects to include, you had several input sessions. You can see on the lower right, pretty good media coverage, getting the word out. You had three input sessions, really four, and then on June 14th, you adopted the plan. And again, this is the plan that was adopted. You can see the total at the bottom, $29.1 million, 21 different funded items. I'm not going to go through these. We're going to update you on each one of these 21, but I'm not going to go through these 1 through 21 because I can group them together in the interest of everybody's time, and so the directors can come up and give some updates. And so there were three items in there that were related to our nonprofit community. Number three was the Arts Council or the Arts Committee funding of $250,000. That money was transferred last year to the Arts Council. They went through an application process similar to what you guys did for the nonprofit funding. And this is my fault. I failed to get a list from the Arts Council of those actual funded programs. But there'll be those organizations similar to what we fund through with our hot money every year to those groups. Obviously, number four, your assistance in nonprofits. You appointed a committee and then took action last month to award those funds to 30 different organizations throughout the community. And just an update on that, contracts have gone out to all those organizations for signature, and they should end up back with the city manager's office here in the next month or so. And then number eight was an additional $100,000 to our partners at the Helen Farabee Center, who the city has historically assisted in funding on an annual basis. This was an additional $100,000, and that was transferred last year. So that was the nonprofit part of this. Some of the transfers to the city with regards to our COVID-related effects, you know that $29.1 million of federal government money is going to require a lot of reporting. As you know, as a matter of fact, you have to over-report these things. And so, out in the guidance and to everybody's benefit, was appropriated $150,000 for the city to hire a grant accountant specifically for the management of these ARPA funds. That has happened. They're on staff. There was money to pay the city back for all the contact tracing from the health department, allocated $585,000. About $250,000 of that to date has been used, but we are still calculating that through this fiscal year. Is that correct? Through this fiscal year as well. And then our police department dispatch overtime, $400,000, and I know the chief is going to come up real quick and brief you on that.
Good morning, Mayor, Council. Our issue with the hiring and dispatch is not just a local issue, it's a national problem that we're facing throughout the nation. It's just can't get people hired to do this very difficult task. We were able, through some meetings, able, without affecting the budget, able to address a little pay issue in dispatch, which has significantly increased our applications into dispatch. Also, we've been able to hire, so now at this point, we're at 30 with four additional. We're about to hire at 34. We fill at 39. So certainly, we are starting to see a light at the end of this tunnel that we hadn't seen before. And what we're hoping now is to see if the retention is sustainable, so that we're hoping that by the end of the year we have enough dispatchers, if not fully staffed, but enough to really decrease the amount of overtime that we're using right now, because we're using a significant amount of overtime due to personnel shortages. Well, the effect on that is I have dispatchers that are working 5-6 days a week, 12 hours a day. And after a while, it just burns them out. And but it's important that we have somebody in that seat. I have 8 seats that I need to fill every day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So to do that, we have to work with what we have. TECO has put a lot of restraints on us. I don't want to say restraints, a lot of improvements on how we do hiring. So it's a little bit more difficult for us to hire personnel than it has been in the past. Now we're required to do background investigations. We're just a lot more that goes to hiring. They also require a lot of certifications now in dispatch. So it's not just be a dispatcher in that. They have to continue their continuing education to get these certifications. And that takes a person away from that seat to do training, which we have to fill. So the vacancies have been very difficult for us. We've tried a lot of solutions that some were not as good as others, but I think we now have a situation where we are seeing more applications come in. We are having a better base to hire people off of, and it looks like the morale in dispatches really increased, that we're not losing. In actuality, we've had a couple come back that had left helped us in our manning. So we're looking at probably about the end of the year to really see whether we can sustain the retention and move forward from there, and hopefully our overtime goes down.
Chief, does this group include 911, just normal calls for information? What does this group, what are their responsibilities?
We usually at a minimum have two 911 callers. We like to have three, but we have two that work the 911 and also our administrative line also. So people that are just calling in, inquiring about different things or need to be transferred or whatever, that comes into the call center as well as the 911. Then we also dispatch for county. We dispatch for fire, our channel one and our channel two also. And then we have to have we really need a supervisor that oversees the whole thing to make sure somebody hadn't dropped the ball somewhere. It's that important. So a lot of seats that have to be filled, but yes, it does include the 911 operators.
Thank you. Yes, on council?
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
So moving on to the project updates, there were several projects funded or recommended for funding through these through the ARPA funds. The Health Department restroom project, that was actually on its way until Christmas Day last year. And so that's on hold while the repairs are due to the flooding incident. But later this year, that project will get rolling again. I know Blake has some updates on a couple of projects here. Number 10, the MLK Center. 11, some broadband infrastructure. And I know Lindsay has a short update on the point of sale system.
Yeah, I don't. The broadband for MLK, we're looking at running fiber from one of our fire stations over there that's close by. So that project we're going to be starting up this summer. Need to visit with John a little bit about that because his crews help us out quite a bit with that, John. So, and then the broadband infrastructure over at the Impact, that'll be Wi-Fi infrastructure for inside the building, and we'll be working with a local provider to help procure that and start that project. So those are both slated for this summer.
As far as the Impact point of sale system, that project has been completed. Those are our food and beverage point of sale systems. We were able to transition to a Square register and utilize Apple's free software. So from a COVID mitigation standpoint, the screen is forward facing, so it is facing the customer. So it limits contact between the customer and our employees who are taking those payments. And the other benefit to it is that we actually see an annual savings on the software of around $11,000. So that one's done, and we've been very happy with it.
Thank you, Hans.
SCADA project. Russell, real briefly, remind us what the SCADA project is and where we are, please.
The SCADA project is the control system. Basically, it's the brains that runs both of our water treatment plants. All the chemical adjustments, water feeds, everything that the operators do to treat the water is basically run through the SCADA system. It also provides us monitoring of all the distribution system, the elevated storage tanks, the pump stations, things like that. That project is close to wrapping up, actually. Hopefully you've seen it in your updates. We're going through factory testing. Actually went through it last week. I don't know the actual results of that just yet. But if the factory testing, where the contractor doesn't have to make a lot of adjustments to it, then they're ready to start installation, which should begin the end of this month. The project is scheduled to wrap up in April of 23, so we'll be back online with the new SCADA system at both Jasper and or Cypress and some improvements to the Jasper system.
Russell, is all of this SCADA infrastructure, the brain, located in one specific area?
At Cypress it is, and then there's a big server room at Cypress where most of it's located, Counselor, and then there's a satellite server at Jasper that communicates back and forth between those two.
Is there a backup if there's
yes
a problem, a fire, an explosion?
Yeah, there's a backup to both these systems are redundant. So if something happened to Cypress, we can go to Jasper and run the system. If something happens to Jasper, vice versa. So, yeah, they are redundant.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else?
There was $2 million set aside for make a small advance in our downtown streetscape project with regards to pedestrian lighting. John's going to come up and kind of give us an update. This is a midterm to a longer term project, but what he's going to talk about is that right there, pedestrian lighting, not street lights at the intersections, but pedestrian lighting.
And concrete, maybe. And maybe. Mayor and Council, we've been working with Downtown Wichita Falls Development to really kind of identify what type of streetlight pole assembly that we're going to use here. One of the renderings, the picture down here on the bottom shows pedestrian lighting. But one of the renderings that we have from the Streetscapes Committee that was formed several years ago had a dual configuration streetlight pole where a higher mast arm illuminated the roadway and then a lower mast arm about halfway down the pole illuminated the sidewalk. We looked for about 2.5 weeks and finally found a assembly that would meet that type of style. It's quite a bit more expensive, so we're kind of evaluating what we would have to cut in order to include these type of light poles. We'll work with Downtown Wichita Falls Development as well as other groups downtown to help finalize that. Once we get a style of pole, then we'll sit down and talk to a lighting engineer. I think that's very important if we're looking at a minimal, acceptable roadway and sidewalk lighting goal, then we need to get a professional in to look at that. Fortunately for us, those blocks are standard length, so we'll be able to take the information on a one-block level and expand it to the 16, 17 blocks in question. At that time, once we get that feedback from the lighting engineer, we'll go ahead and make the order for the streetlight poles and fixtures. What we're looking at right now is cutting out where we'll place the poles and then using an underground boring technique to go from hole to hole to do that. One thing I think we will do is use a much larger conduit, and the reason we're looking at that is it'll give us expandability. If we wanted to add some metered electrical service, say for like phone charging stations, if we want to look at festivals and having the ability to access electricity, we're not having to run things across the sidewalk. We can do that relatively easy. If we wanted to look at some type of not only festival lighting but holiday lighting, we would have that ability as well. Now, that would be outside the scope of work from my traffic engineering staff. That would require an electrical contractor to come in and do that work, but we would have the infrastructure in place if we wanted to add those additional bells and whistles down the road. As soon as we can get the streetlight pole assembly identified, then we'll come to council with that. We'll have a much more detailed presentation at that time when we formally budget the $2 million. So at that time, we'll work into the details there. But that's where we're at today, and I'll be more than happy to try to answer any questions that you may have.
Steve?
John, how many streetlights are we looking at this time?
It's going to be anywhere from 180 to 240 poles and mast arms. The fixtures may be double that if we go with the two mast arm type assembly, but we're looking at 180 to 240 poles right now.
Thank you, sir.
And to put it in perspective, right now we've got four poles per block. They're 400 watt equivalent type fixtures. I think they use about 160 watts since they're LED. They work great as long as there's no trees surrounding the poles, the light fixture. That's probably our biggest problem downtown, is the fact that the trees have grown so much over the last 40, 50 years that we've got quite a few street light fixtures. We'd probably be better off taking them down. In order to improve upon the lighting, we'd have to do some serious damage to those trees to make access for the light fixture.
Is there any way to possibly make these solar to help with the electricity cost?
The problem with that would be batteries, I think, and you could go with LED in some application. That's why I think we need to get a lighting engineer to look at that. We'll ask them to look at that.
John, I assume these street lights, you know where I'm going, will be the dark skies type lights.
They very well could be, yes, sir. And all of our new LED technology incorporated the dark sky technologies. And again, it will depend on the style of fixture. We're going for more traditional, more antique type, historical flair. So we'll see if we can find some fixtures that would incorporate the dark sky technology.
I'd explain that briefly for the citizens.
So one of the things, and if you live in the middle of urban areas, you can't see the stars at night. These fixtures, basically what they do is they funnel the light downward, and there's not much light going sideways. It gives you the ability to look up in the night sky and enjoy it a little better.
Thank you.
Chief Prilliman is going to come up and remind us what PPE is, with personal protection equipment. And then we've got a couple of other city project updates that Blake will give after that.
Morning, Mayor and Council. Just one correction to the slide. Mr. Minzi and I communicated this morning. We're not quite completed on this project. PPE, as a reminder, is personal protective equipment. And more specifically, it's the suppression rated turnout coat and pants. We ordered additional sets as a first step towards creating a cache and allowing the quartermaster to deliver clean, dry, fitted gear to firefighters after exposing their assigned gear in a fire. Company that we use, when we ordered them originally, had a 15-month delivery time. So this is a classic supply chain issue. They have since purchased another textile company, converted it to a gear manufacturer, and has reduced their delivery time to 9 months, so I'm expecting that we'll have that gear before the end of the fiscal year. The lockers are coming out of a company in Minnesota, and we have a delivery date, which is the last week of March, that will cover locker needs in the four oldest stations. Deputy Chief Hughes is developing a detailed plan of pulling the old lockers out. We've got a couple of rooms that need some touch-up, some repair, some painting. He's working through that process, and I'm expecting that those would get installed the first week of April. They'll bring installers in. It was included in our price, and they'll be able to install all four stations, I think, in 3 days, if not 4 days. So it'll be quick once we get them here. We'll have just a few shifts where crews will have some very inconvenient times as we move their existing lockers out of the way to make room for the new ones.
Thank you, Chief. Hold on, Michael's got a question for you, Chief.
Chief.
So sorry.
I'd be interested in seeing some before and after photographs of this. I know you said that there'll be additional space for each firefighter's locker.
Yeah.
And I just kind of like to understand how that's going to fit in the space you've got. So how about that?
Absolutely, Counselor. And I can assure you that we're going to take a lot of pictures. This is a big deal to get this done. You know, the firefighters will tell you. They've put up with these very tiny little lockers for a very long time, and they're all excited about having some more space. So we'll make certain that we come back and show you the installed product.
Thanks. Anybody else? Thank you.
The next one here is the parking lot out at Lake Wichita that we have $870,000 budget for. Chris did a great job of taking this picture because he took it right after a rain, so it really accentuates the potholes and stuff out there. But kind of what the plan is for this, you can see in the background over here on this one picture is the construction of the Veterans Plaza that's going on. So our plan is when they finish up is when we'll start this parking lot. We didn't want to get in there and put in the new parking lot and drive to allow, you know, so that they could tear up with their big equipment. So their plan is to be finished with that project, I believe it's early June. So I talked to Blaine Boswell this morning, and he's working on the plans and design work for the parking lot. We'll bid that out at the end of April, so we'll have it ready to go at the end, at the 1st of June. So we'll come in right on the tails of this project and get this parking lot repaved and fixed up. Any questions on that one? I'm sorry.
Any questions?
The next one, number 12, we've talked about this one quite a bit. That's a renovation of this this facility. You can see on the 17th, Council approved the CMAR contract with Inman. And the next step is really to come back to Council sometime this summer with a cost estimate on a guaranteed maximum price on this project. And, you know, we've been meeting with Anthony and his team and our architects weekly. And I can assure you there's no shortage of work on this project. This is a big project. There's a lot of moving parts. You know, we're working on trying to figure out how we move staff out of this building. How do you coordinate that and actually get that done? I mean, there's a lot of pieces of this, and we're trying to also determine, you know, what phases it makes sense to do this in the most cost-effective way. So we're looking at, you know, possibly renting some space or finding some space and the best ways to handle that. So we'll have an update on that probably around the time we do our GMP on what our actual finished product's going to look like and what the plans are there. But like I said, there's a lot of moving pieces right now. We're working through the programming as well right now, which the programming is, you know, where would we shuffle staff and where would the new offices be, or they stay in the same place. So we're working through that right now. Any questions on that project?
Like on this picture, I'm assuming the brown area on the field is turf.
Well, yeah, that's.
Is that true?
Yes, that's okay. That's the next project number, the turf at the complex. Yes, sir.
Okay, and are you getting more requests for information? Having more tournaments coming?
Oh yes, sir. On the turf.
Yeah.
Yes, that was the next one we were going to talk about. So the we've got three of the fields complete, so we've got one more to finish, and we're hoping the 1st of March they'll be done. They moved a little quicker than we expected, but we have 12 tournaments booked from, I believe the first one is the last week of March, and it goes through the middle of July. So there's a 17-week period there that we actually have 12 weekends booked for tournaments. So we're very excited about that. There's, I think, 9 youth baseball tournaments and 3 youth softball tournaments.
And that is an increase in the number of tournaments.
Absolutely, yeah. We've struggled to get tournaments out there regularly since the drought. So this is great. I mean, our goal for Parks is to have 24 events out there a year at the sports complex. This is 12 of them that we'll have before summer, so they're also working on the fall schedule now. We're getting a lot of inquiries about a fall schedule. Once summer gets here, there's a lot of family vacations, and those tournaments do drop off also because of the heat. But I really anticipate next year, you know, we really held the month of March free. We didn't want to book anything in the month of March because of construction. So next year, being able to do January and March, we'll probably get another 5 tournaments to add to these 12. So, yeah, the response has been real well. I mean, this is going to be a great asset. I mean, these tournaments bring in, you know, people from over 60 miles out, so that most of them spend the night, and you know, it's great for economic impact as well.
Thank you, Councilor Smith. Just to add what Blake said, you know, you all voted on a fee adjustment. That was to replace this $3.3 million so the taxpayers, you know, can receive a little bit of increase in the rental for that turf.
Yes,
and it's still below what a lot of cities that have turf fields charge. But anyway, that was part of the reason is we know eventually we're going to have to replace these turf fields, and we want to have a little bit of money coming in for that as well. So it's an exciting project.
Yeah, there's one other thing just kind of on that touch on with Darren mentioned is that's one thing we're really going to evaluate. We did quite a bit of research on what to charge for those turf fields, looking at our sister cities and other cities and what they charge. But during the budget process, this coming budget process, we'll adjust the fees, and we'll really look into that to make sure we're competitive and making sure that we're recouping some costs for these tournaments that come in. And there's lots of different ways that these tournaments want to operate. So we want to generate some flexibility in there too that would allow us to do other leasing opportunities, much the way they do at the Ag Center, something where you can negotiate the fees and like Darren said, help generate a little bit of income to pay for a replacement next down the road. So.
So this is the last piece of the update. And so number one on your list, you remember, and again, you approved the ARPA funding list in June of last year, just as your budget process was getting underway. And then, of course, you adopted your budget in September. And so what number one was potentially every year directors of the community come forth with, hey, you're not doing this year, but why don't you consider doing this next year, those budget enhancements. And so you set aside $550,000 potentially to fund some of those that may have been eligible. Well, either through just the budget itself or through a number of the projects that Jessica's going to go over with the excess fund balance, you took care of a lot of that. And so that $550,000 remains unused. You also adopted a contingency in there, $1.1 million. And then we talked earlier about how the federal guidance continues to change, and that's certainly been the case since you adopted this plan. We briefed you kind of on number 16 in your weekly. You had $1.5 million set aside for new fire trucks and equipment, our new front line. You remember there's an $11 million there's $11 million plan. Fire trucks have been purchased. Matter of fact, they are expected to be delivered sometime this fiscal year for the next 6 months. That type of and the plan was to take $1.5 million towards a principal payment to that $11 million. That is no longer allowed for in the guidance. Saying that, that doesn't change the payment plan because you already had that set up and everything was ready to go. Doesn't change the delivery date. Doesn't change anything with regards to the fire truck project. We just can't make this principal payment with the ARPA fund. This remains an unused amount, as well as what you had set aside for future capital infrastructure and for future capital equipment. And so those three, 16, 18, and 21 on your list, the guidance has changed since last June, and those are no longer eligible projects. So what does that mean? Well, it means your contingency line is effectively about $5.5 million right now. And I suspect your next questions are going to be, well, what are we going to use that for? I'm looking right at Councilor Smith because I know he's about to ask that. Well, again, you're about to start budget discussions for FY24, so I'm sure that'd be a good time to go through that and see what comes out then. And a reminder, again, we don't need to allocate these funds today or tomorrow, but certainly by the end of 24, and then projects need to wrap up by 26. And so that is the update. Everybody's here if you have any questions.
I got one quick question. On that last, on the contingency on it, what are we able to do, move that around to? What fund? Or what project?
Well, I mean, there's like I said, just
up in there.
It'd be a lot of things. Yeah, I mean, you still got several projects that, like, John was talking about with the streetscapes, Blake was talking about with regard to this building. We don't have cost estimates or definitive cost estimates on those projects yet, so that may be something to consider. Plus, again, like I said, there may be other projects that are identified through your discussions over the next several months for next year's budget.
So in other words,
To be determined.
To be determined, yes.
At a later date.
Yeah. And council, remember, there's restrictions on that. So
yeah,
we just can't
restriction?
Take it and, you know, use it to pave a street on Taft or something like that.
Oh, there's no restrictions.
There are restrictions.
Well, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah,
what
there are restrictions. Well, those are all the restrictions we went over with you last summer when you approved these projects. We can get that sent to you, but the list from U.S. Treasury is about that thick of restrictions. But remember, last summer there were projects that we had on your list that we liked to put on the list, but we didn't have funding for.
Right.
So you may want to circle back and look at those identified but unfunded projects as well. So to say all that, it will be determined here over the next few months because, as Paul said, we've got to, you know, get those programmed by the end of 24, so we can't wait too long. Same token, you know, we need to wait till we get cost estimates on some of these projects so that doesn't come back and bite us.
I'm thinking the 12.5 for the Memorial Auditorium. I mean, I think as we start digging, we better hold back some of this for contingency because I can just see it escalating. But
100-year-old building, what could go wrong?
That's right.
When you tear walls apart.
But so my first thought is and I think we could probably in that 12.5, we already have some contingency, but I just think that we might want to think about holding another little chunk back. Anybody else? Michael?
I want to remind everyone, and maybe a lot of people didn't realize, these monies we're talking about that did so much for this city started with COVID as the impetus, but it's kind of blossomed. If you look through this list, and there are many items that might have never been taken on by the city, raised taxes. But there are social services, there are quality of life issues, there are infrastructure issues, and gosh, I'd hate to think that, you know, we'd go through something else like COVID to maybe get this kind of funding. But isn't it wonderful? It's there. And we're going to use it, and it's kind of a return for all of us on our federal income tax. That's kind of the way I look at it, but gosh, this is wonderful. So thanks for all the work city staff has done on getting this together, overseeing it, and making sure it's spent in the best way for our city.
Else?
Okay. All right, Jessica's up.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Mr. Mayor, members of council. So I have a couple of presentations for y'all this morning. I'm going to start with an update on your one-time project list. So let me find the clicker. There we go. So as a reminder, this is the list of one-time projects that you approved in the current year's budget. So the list totals $17.9 million across all funds. And as a reminder, the one-time purchases are made with fund balance that is in excess of fund balance policies, so is available to be used for one-time purchases. So what Blake and I are going to do is run you through the list with a current update of where we are on each of these items. We kept this one short and sweet. We don't have a whole lot of pictures of a lot of these projects until we get a little bit further down the line. But I will start at the top and then Blake will we'll take turns. So we'll start with the police tactical SWAT vehicle, the MRAP. So that vehicle you have approved. If you all remember, you did have an item that came to you in the fall, so that was approved for purchase. We have ordered it, but we don't anticipate actually receiving it until we're into next fiscal year. So as we go through the budget process and we get to that process we do every December where we carry forward funds, you may see that vehicle on that list if it hasn't been received yet.
Golf course pavilion and range lighting, that project is underway. I've been working with a architect on that. They had a pre-development meeting with Terry Floyd and his folks last week. So that's moving forward. We should have the design finished within the next probably 2 weeks, and then we'll get that project bid out to hopefully to get the pavilion built and the restrooms. And we're still in the design phase of the lighting for the range. But that is moving forward. If you look down at the bottom, I guess two lines from the bottom, there's a golf course fund for irrigation and capital improvements. At $205,000. So that's, I don't know if I explained this correctly, but that's the use of fund balance that we've generated over the last couple of years at the golf course. So that one line item plus this is what we come up with the money and the funds for those projects. So hopefully that explains that. Did I do okay?
You did. Okay. You did. That's fantastic.
The timeline, we'll get the pavilion done. Midsummer. I mean, I want to be able to use it. We have a lot of tournaments that come in through the summer. Probably won't make the first few, but for sure midsummer, late summer, and then into fall when we have those tournaments, we'll have those pavilions complete. So the irrigation we're working on right now. Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah. We're working on that as we move forward. We've got some old pump motors out there that have met the end of their life, so we are working on those as well. I'll move on to the Castaway Cove. I put it in my update this week, but we, as you recall, we went with a new management company this year. So this spring right now, they're out there doing a lot of work on updating, buffing slides and cleaning up and doing some needed repair on the kiddie park and in that area. And then probably in March, we'll start working on the design of the new slide. So we'll get with a team together to start evaluating the new slide. I think we've talked about a mat racer, so that hasn't changed. But we'll start that project, work on that through the summer, get it procured and ready to go. So when they close in September, we'll be able to get started, because it'll take the whole off season to get that built and constructed and ready for spring of 2024.
So the next item that we have on the list is the MPEC co-promotional show fund. So that $100,000 from the general fund was moved into the hotel motel fund, which is the fund that MPEC operates out of. And at this point in time, MPEC has not found a use yet for those funds, but Lindsay is working on that. So those funds are available for times when she needs to bring in an outside show that we really feel like needs to come to our area. This is a pot of money that she can use when she needs to have funds for bringing those transactions or those attractions into town. The next is on the MPEC remodel, and I'm going to move us forward a little bit so that Blake can talk about this with some pictures for you.
So as you recall, there's $2.5 million dollars available for this, and $2 million of it was for gap funding to start the renovations of the MPEC. And you can see that some of it's already started. This is the meeting room 1 through 4. That's just right inside the pre-function area. So you can see the picture on the right is some new finishes, and you can see on the left that's the old the aqua colored stuff. So you can see a little bit of progress moving forward there. So they're moving pretty quickly over there. I know that the pre-function area, are these the only two pictures? Oh, yep, there we go. There's the pre-function area. The picture on the left is just right outside of the doorway that we were just looking into those meeting rooms. So you can see they've got some the new ceiling in place. They're working on the lighting and the putting the grates back in. They've started the construction of the framing around the doors. So, and the picture on the right was just kind of a reminder of what it did look like. So you can see that the improvements are being made there, and I think they're working through this construction while having events. So there are some, if you know, over the next several months, if you go to an event over there, you will see some construction going on. But
The next is an additional $2 million that we programmed in the general fund for street improvements. That work is ongoing. I know Russ has bid out some portions of that already this year and brought those to you over the last couple of months. So that work will continue as we get into the spring and summer. The in-car video infrastructure, I'm going to let Blake talk to you a little bit about that one. That is a project for the police department.
Yeah, so this is kind of the other half of the project that I know Councilor Nelson's been interested in is the infrastructure that will support the body cams. But as you'll recall, we do have a grant application out for that project, for the body cam piece of it. So this is the infrastructure and the car in-car video piece of it. And we're working with the vendor right now, getting quotes and getting that project moving. But I think the chief updated us a meeting or two ago. It's going to be probably late summer before we really get moving on this project. Parks Master Plan, we're started working with purchasing on that. We're going to get the RFQ or RFP out for a consultant to come in and help us with that project. And our Parks Board will be heavily involved in this project as well. I mean, this will, our last plan was ended in 2010, and it was a 10-year plan, so it expired in 2020, so we are a little overdue on that, but we are looking forward to getting that project moving. So we'll start the evaluation and trying to find a partner on that project, and we'll get started. Probably be June before we actually start seeing some surveys and stuff go out. Recreation equipment and replacement. We've actually brought that to council. Most of that's some of that was for the library improvements, rec center improvements, and then John Burris brought some. I believe we bought 3 new lawn mowing tractors and stuff. So that project has been wrapped up and complete.
The health department reception area remodel has hit the same snags that the ARPA health department project did, which was the flood on Christmas. So right now the plan is to hopefully get both of those projects started concurrently in April, depending, of course, upon the work being completed to get power back to the building, the remediation completion and all of that over at the health department.
The public safety facility needs assessment, I think, has probably hit the same flood wall as she just talked about, because that project we were wanting to get started already on, but our building maintenance staff's been pretty tied up with that project. But we've got we did a needs assessment back in 2017 as part of the bond project. So we did a needs assessment for the PD and a partial one for the fire department. So we'll pick those back up and start those conversations within the next few weeks, probably to a month, and we'll start that project. So
you'll see on this list that you have a contingency listed. So your contingency here is about $800,000. As we go through and complete these projects that we see on the upper part of the list, we will use these funds if needed to complete these projects as you have asked that they be completed. Any items for these projects come to you, so you have a kind of an extra benefit here. You see this and we talk about it as we go through the budget process, and over those presentations during the summer we come up and we talk about it, and then we also come forward and bring items to you for your approval as we award each one of these particular projects or purchases. At the end of the year, if we do not have any need for that contingency, as a reminder, that rolls back into fund balance. It doesn't go anywhere. It doesn't get used for anything else. It becomes part of what may be in your available fund balance in the next year. So if we look down here at the lower portion of this graph, these are the items that are from fund balance for these particular projects in these particular funds. So this is just separating out from what the general fund total was to what these other funds are providing. So in sanitation, if you'll recall last year in the budget, we talked at length about about adding a landfill scale out at the landfill and replacing a compactor. So out at the landfill right now, the work is underway on the scale. The temporary scale has been installed and the road and grading has been completed. And the compactor has been ordered and has shipped. It is on its way into the U.S. now. So we are hoping that that will arrive over the next several months. In the Stormwater Fund, we're continuing to work on Quail Creek. And I'm actually going to ask Russ to give you a little bit more information on Quail Creek, because this is a project over the last 2 to 3 years we've talked about at length during the budget process. So this is a great time for Russ to give you kind of an update on where we're at there and what some of our holdup on that has been.
Well, the Quail Creek project, most of you are probably pretty familiar with that. It did hit a few snags along the way. There was a few adjacent property owners that turned out to be opposed to that project, although it does give a tremendous benefit to the overall drainage of the city. We had to back up. Originally, the channel was determined to be non-jurisdictional by the Corps of Engineers, and then there were some potential lawsuits that may get filed against the city against it. So the Corps backed up and said, hey, why don't you go ahead and get a 404 permit for the project, which took another 5 to 6 months, which we did. And then there was a aquatic relocation program that had to be, or plan that had to be approved by the Parks and Wildlife, which we got approved. We actually relocated all the aquatic life from that pond last week. The pond is now drained, and city staff today should be over there breaching the dam so that the pond doesn't reestablish the aquatic life. The plan is, the final plans, construction plan, should be completed by the end of this month and ready to bid by March to April timeframe, with hopefully a construction start time sometime around June or July. Get that project moving forward. It will be a tremendous benefit to the flooding on Maplewood and Kemp Street that we see now very frequently. It'll also improve some flooding in all the neighborhoods that are adjoining the Quail Creek project there. So hopefully we can keep that project moving forward.
And then the last couple on our list, we have already talked about the golf course funding, but the last is the IT funds project for the public safety radio replacement. And Blake has another update on that.
Yeah, we're moving that project forward. We're replacing all of the handheld radios for police and fire, and then this includes some infrastructure, some back office software upgrade and infrastructure. So this project is underway. We've brought action to council, so the contract's been awarded, and we'll have this finished up by early summer.
Okay, so this is what we have for you on this list. I'm going to leave the list in front of us in case y'all have any questions at this time.
Michael? Russell, where did that aquatic life go to?
We moved it into Sykes Lake behind. We actually took it to where Sykes Lake crosses Maplewood and put it in there. I don't have the final report exactly what all they took out of there, but there were some fish, there were some snapping turtles. That's all I can recall, Counselor. There weren't any water moccasins or snakes that I'm aware of.
Alligators?
No alligators that I'm aware of.
Thank you, Russell.
Rusty shopping
cart or something. That pond, I'd like to go see it. I don't even know how deep that pond was.
It's about 5 or 6 feet deep. Yeah, not enough to cover up some shopping carts and some other debris down in there. Hopefully it won't stay that way very long. Hopefully we'll be able to roll right into this project. And I know it's probably frustrating for some of the adjoining property owners there to see it drain now in just a kind of a mud hole. But we have to get it drained, get the dam out of there so the water can move on through and then get the construction started. And hopefully it'll be a nice improvement. It'll be a concrete line. It'll be a concrete bottom channel. And then the sidewalls will be the stacked block like you see around Sykes Lake. So it'll be aesthetically pleasing. It won't just be regular concrete walls like you see on the other side of Kemp and the Quail Creek Channel. So hopefully we can get that project moving along. The biggest obvious hurdle in there is there's going to be a lot of those trees that have to come down, and I think that's probably a sore spot. But most of those have to come down. That 80-foot easement was established way back in the 80s in there, and so hopefully we'll get that done.
So where the Duncan Channel, where exactly is that?
It crosses Duncan Street over there. I don't recall it's on the east side. I can't recall the street it's between there, Counselor. But the plan there, that Duncan Channel kind of drains that east side into the river. And during when we have a flood event, there's a set of gates on that channel that discharge into the river. When the river gets up so high, we close those gates and we install temporary pumps there to pump the water over the berm. Eventually, the river gets up so high it backfeeds in from the other collection and fills up anyway. But we do buy some time with the temporary pumping. The gates on the Duncan Channel are the shafts on those things are bent. We got a project in design now to replace those gates so that they'll function and operate during a large flood event. But it is over on the east side. I can't recall which street it's between, but I can show you on the map sometime.
What about Ray Road?
Ray Road is the next project. We need to get Quail Creek bid and Duncan Channel bid. Ray Road was kind of put in there. I don't know that we'll get to Ray Road this year, Counselor. I think the Quail Creek Channel and Duncan Channel will use up all the funding, and then we may have to slow roll that a little bit. There are some additional phases to Quail Creek. The first phase just gets us up to Maplewood. There'll be a next phase, which will replace the culverts under Maplewood, that channel in behind Barwise Junior High, and then the culverts under Kemp that will be improved with the next phase. We'll start on that just as quick as we can. So Ray Road will probably get pushed off quite a ways, to be honest with you.
Anybody else?
Russell, and I might mention this for those watching, when Quail Creek project is finished, flooding that was really a problem on the south end of Fillmore, where it comes up to that channel,
right,
that will be solved. And those folks have suffered for
right
many floods.
Right. Most of those flooding events will be alleviated, Councilor Smith. I don't believe it'll alleviate the 100-year flood event, but the 25, 30, 40, 50-year events, it'll certainly alleviate those.
Yep. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Okay, well, that's all that I have for this presentation. I'm going to move us on into the budget calendar for next year. So this will give us an idea of where we are going as we get this process started. And I know if y'all are like me, you're thinking, gosh, we do this earlier every year. And yes, yes, we do. Yes, we do.
I feel like we just got out of a budget.
We did. We did. So this is the prior year's calendar, just for a point of reference for y'all. So we kicked off last year on March 8th. We are kicking off a bit prior to that this year, but we are going to run pretty much in line with where we were last year, in that last year on the 6th of September, we adopted the budget, and then in this coming year, we're going to adopt just about at the same time. So if we take a look at next year's calendar, so here is today. Today we're talking about the calendar. I'm presenting it to y'all. Part of the reason that we started doing this a couple of years ago is to get y'all's input early on. If you see things within the calendar that you know will not work for you for some reason, we would really like to get your feedback as early as possible. We are going to kick off the internal budget process on March the 3rd. So that's when we will meet with, I will meet with directors and with all internal budget staff. We'll talk about expectations as we go into the next year. We will talk about the internal process to get requests into the budget. And we are making some changes internally this year. We are broadening this process quite a bit. We're adding some additional checkpoints and things of that nature within the process. So as we go through that, those internal changes are going to happen from March the 3rd to May the 8th. And around that time, we're going to start meeting with the city manager for city manager budget meetings. As a reminder, that's a time when each of the directors sits down with the budget team and the city manager to discuss requests for the next year. This is also where we review our above current requests. Those are the requests that are outside of our general operating in the current year, but that we'd like to implement in the next year. And then we will have our pre-budget workshop. So that's when I will come back at that point in June, and we will talk about all of the things going on within the city's finances. We're going to talk about the current year's budget. We're going to talk about where we are in current year purchasing. We'll give another update on ARPA. We're going to talk about what kinds of economic impacts and factors are affecting the city at that point in time. And we'll talk a little bit, too, about anything that's happening nationally that may have an effect on our economy. Then throughout the rest of June and into July, our team will work on getting the proposed budget together to submit to you for review on the 25th of July. And then we've included this year what we added last year, which is this July 31 to August 8th timeframe. So this is an opportunity for City Council. You will have received the proposed budget. And we'll do that condensed version of the proposed budget that we did last year so that we won't be presenting all 500 pages to you to read between the 25th and the 31st. But from the 31st to the 8th, if you have any questions at all, that's a time to come in and meet with us, to sit down with the budget team. If you have any feedback, any ideas on things you'd like to see changed, that's really when I'm asking that you come and meet with us, and that Darren's asking as well, to let us know what your thoughts are at that point in time. So we implemented this last year. We didn't have a whole lot of input at that point, so if we can increase the input this year, I would thoroughly appreciate it. We really want to hear what y'all think and give the time to get those potential changes actually implemented into the process. And then on Tuesday the 8th, we are proposing to do a budget workshop that will be a special meeting. So that's one that's not going to be on your calendars. So if you have something planned around that time in August, I would ask that you take a look at that now, because at this point, as far as we are planning with your input, is to go forward with that special meeting. Last year, you'll recall, we did two special meetings, and that just had to do with how the calendar fell, what kind of schedules we were looking at in the summertime. So this year, what we're looking at is just the one special meeting. Then we'll go ahead and do our public hearing on the 15th, and we will plan to adopt on the 5th of September. On the 5th of September, you adopt the budget, you do a public hearing on the tax rate, we adopt the tax rate, and you adopt the capital improvement plan. So for everyone on council, very, very similar to exactly what we did last year.
We get these to Pam, so just go ahead and pre-plug them in. And
and we'll send out all these presentations too, but we'll get the dates on your calendar.
Anybody else? Any questions?
Is that a the city council meet with the budget team? Is that a one on, or more than one, just one person
one at on a time? Yeah, and the idea there, Councilor Brewer, is, you know, if you have questions and you want to sit down around a table with the budget team and have the budget book spread out and say, well, what's this? What's this? That's your opportunity to do that. So we just want to make ourselves available. Should you have any desire to come in and do that.
Okay.
Anybody else? All right, thank you, Jess.
Thank you.
Hey, Mayor, that's all staff reports.
Okay. I'll announce concerning community interest from a member of the City Council. Steve?
I just want to thank everyone who was involved in the presentations and the work that you do. I'm sure it doesn't stop at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. I'm sure it goes past that. We know that you do a lot of work, and it's hard to make things work on the amount of money that were available. So I know there's things that some people think are not essential to Wichita Falls, but just like the golf course, I don't play golf. Tried it before, but I don't play golf, and I don't go to the water park, but a lot of people do. A lot of people play golf, and those things are essential to Wichita Falls having people come, as well as the impact. And I'm just glad that we're getting things done to where they are upgraded, and so we don't look like a rundown town.
This Friday, we're having a ceremony where a street is being renamed, and I forget the name of the street that's going to lose its name.
That'll be the new street.
What's the street that we're...
Cleveland.
Okay. Cleveland.
Cleveland Street. Cleveland will to change Cleaver. To Cleaver Street. And that's to honor Mr. Cleaver, who was a Tuskegee Airman during World War II and worked in civil service for many years after that, even here at Shepherd. So that would be a great opportunity to honor a living World War II vet for his service. Thank you.
Jeff? I'm good to go. Yeah, go ahead.
We've got a Boys and Clubs
Girls Club broke ground on March the 7th at 10 a.m. along with the city council meeting. Is there some way maybe we could back that up to where we can attend?
To the mayor.
Okay, say it again.
On your meeting. So.
On the Boys and Girls Club, it's going to be breaking ground. On the first, on March 7th, and it's going to be breaking ground on North Rosewood at 10 a.m. Is there any way that we could maybe back that up to so we can attend to it? I'm sure our meeting won't be over by then.
We definitely wouldn't be over.
Let me pull
council and see what. That'll be a tough one. And I can also talk to, I'll make some phone calls.
Okay. That's in your district, Mr. Councilman Nelson. So,
just don't come.
Just don't come. I mean, I'd like to go. I mean,
yeah. I can call Paul and see. I'll make stuff note to after this to call. Okay. I've got nothing. Nobody signed up. Okay. That gets us through to item 9. Item 10 is an executive session, so we're now going to convene an executive session in accordance with Texas Government Code 551.071 and 551.072, and I will be back to adjourn us. Thank you.
We good?
Yeah, we're good.
All right. We have now reconvened out of executive session where no votes or polls were taken. That brings us to item number 11, which is adjournment. So if we have no other items to come for this council, we are adjourned. Thank you.